Hi, everyone. I've just received word. It's time for me to get started. It's a little after one. And my name is Kathe Petchel, and I am with Hinge Brokers, Hinge Early Education. And I am here today to present to you a webinar about communication strategies for staff engagement. Oh my gosh, just before we start, we need to take a deep breath because we are coming out of COVID and there's still some things going on with, you know, different strains of the virus, but everything is looking really good and ready to go for fall. And I just think we need to take a moment to celebrate. We've all done a great job getting through all of this. And, you know, I don't have any magic answers, but what I do at Hinge is talk to owners all day long. And I love what I do. I'm actually an owner myself, so I am in the trenches with all of you. We debated about staffing versus a marketing webinar for this for today's date, and we thought let's settle down with the staffing and then go full swing, full speed ahead with enrollment. So that'll be, I think, the next one that you'll be getting an email about the date and time for that. But I am super excited to be here. As I said, I'm an owner myself. I have three schools in Charlottesville, Virginia. I'm actually in Virginia now, and 30 minutes ago I finished interviewing a director. So I'm literally right with you. Today, I'm hoping to give you some great strategies on engaging with our staff. And so I'm just gonna go ahead and get started right now and hopefully be able to give you lots of great updates. So today's agenda, first of all, I'm gonna talk about some news and updates that we've got at Hinge. There's lots of very exciting things happening in our world. We straddle between helping people sell their schools or grow their schools or just add quality. And so I'll give you a couple updates. I'll do a little bit of talking about servant leadership. I always like to share books. This is a servant leadership book, but honestly, if you go to Amazon or Google servant leadership, there's so much information. You don't even actually need to buy the book. You can learn about servant leadership, which is what I'll talk a little bit about today. And then really just talking about intentional communication. How do we actually plan to communicate with our teams and our staff? Of course, it can trickle into how we communicate with our parents and our students, of course. You know, we're communicators, you know, as educators. We teach the children, we teach the families. And then we'll have some time for Q&A. And I've got Carrie Pergerson from our team also on the webinar. She'll keep me straight with time. And we've got Molly Petchel Hitchens. She's been married a couple of years and now she just changed her name. She's here in Virginia helping me as well. So between us, I think we can answer all your questions. Starting with latest news and updates from Hinge. Let me be the first to welcome you to our amazing in-person conference. Shift Orange County takes place October 5th through 8th. We've secured an amazing venue. It's called the Balboa Bay Resort. It's in Newport Beach, California. We are almost full. You missed the early bird rates, but there's still time to register. I highly recommend this conference if you are in need of figuring out an exit strategy or succession plan, if you're wanting to grow, and if you're really wanting a lot of networking. We've got quite a few people that attended our Thrive event a couple months back, it was virtual, that are coming. So they're really looking forward to networking and meeting new people. We have just rock stars in the industry attending, as well as some amazing speakers. So I'm really excited. In particular, Jen Lim is speaking on her new book, everything relating to happiness in the workplace. So check out our website for a little bit more details. And you may have gotten our emails about our key speakers, our keynote speakers. Another great keynote and a personal friend of mine is Travis Steba from Indeed. It will be his third year in a row because 3 years running now, we've had lots of staffing issues and he is the go-to guy on the formulas and the strategy and sort of the behind the scenes at Indeed and what we can do to leverage our staffing and you know, how to recruit sort of from a different point of view. I'm actually hoping he'll do a work session, like a workshop breakaway as well. At any rate, he's awesome, and he's the best brain to pick in terms of hiring. I think I referenced this earlier, but the childcare market is very hot right now. If you are thinking about your exit or your succession plan, now's the time to call us. This is our regular info email, but you can also call me or email me, kpetchel@hingebrokers.com. Always happy to point you in the right direction. I actually work in the client relations piece with Hinge. So I do a lot of talking to owners as they're thinking about exiting. Sometimes it's a 6 month to 1 or 2 year plan. Sometimes they want out as soon as possible. And what's really amazing right now, especially coming out of COVID, is that the buyers are very interested in our industry. And there's quite a lot of interest from private equity groups, as well as some international groups. So I love when I'm talking to owners that I can really tell them, there's so many choices. And it's not just about that paycheck you'll get when you sell, but it's also about making sure that you're leaving your legacy and, your program that you've worked so many years on is taken over and in such good hands. So I love when our owners get to choose who the buyer is. It's one of my favorite things ever. And so we're going to get started with the content for today. So the first thing I like to talk about is servant leadership. And a lot of you do this already naturally. You just might not know that that's what it's called. It really starts, it's very like old fashioned terminology. Sam Walton from Walmart and Sam's Club started it many years ago in his company. And the idea is that if we're serving our staff and then they're serving the families, everyone is served. So rather than putting ourselves first as the owners or the CEOs or the heads of our companies, we're leading by focusing on our employees first. So traditional leadership focuses on helping an organization and, of course, helping our organizations grow. And, the bottom line and achieving our quarterly goals is incredibly important. But many hands make a lighter load. And so putting our employees first is the servant leadership model. Servant leaders focus on developing individuals who perform their best. And in another webinar, or possibly at Shift, I'd really like to talk about a couple great TED Talks that our team has just listened to. There's some really good ones where it talks about, instead of just finding like the best and the brightest and the strongest, sometimes the regular, steady Eddies do the best job helping us. So, growing our team with everyone's strengths and skill sets is an awesome strategy. Historical examples of servant leaders. I mean, these are kind of fun ones. I mean, Abraham Lincoln. If you Google these names with servant leadership, you're going to get lots of great information. And sometimes when I do webinars like this, I like to point out different ways to look at things, and that's actually what teachers do, right? So why would, or what do Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King Jr., and Mother Teresa have in common? That would be a great question to stump your staff at your professional development day, probably coming up soon. And one thing they have in common is they're great servant leaders. They knew that they, obviously put other people first. All three of them put other people first and led by example. And we do that in our schools and we know we do it. But if we can convey that to our staff and our teachers in the classroom that, we serve each other, so that when, someone's running late, someone will take over the shift or someone needs a day off because there's a family emergency, the staff are helpful rather than resentful. Four principles of servant leadership. And these are kind of hard sometimes because we set up our culture and our core values and here's who we are and here's what we do. So number one is a little bit difficult sometimes, encouraging diversity of thought. We think, no, our philosophy is this. Well, our philosophy still could be, play-based learning, for instance, but how could we diversify it? And one thing that's really interesting sitting here in 2021 is that we are working with so many generations. It's almost, I don't know when it'll happen again, but you think your Gen Zers, you know, your 16 or 18 year olds that might work part-time for you or just in the summers, all the way to the greatest generation. One of my favorite teachers at my school is Miss Tina, who's 78. And so she works side by side with a Gen Zer incredibly well. Talk about diversity of thought and talk about how they can learn from each other. So that would be a great example in her classroom of her being a servant leader and promoting diversity of thought, as well as her coworker. Creating a culture of trust, obviously, for servant leadership, really in any good organization, a culture of trust is very important and desired. Having an unselfish mindset is an example of servant leadership as well, being unselfish, putting others first, and then fostering leadership in others. I think number four is my favorite one and my biggest challenge right now, as we're coming back from COVID, fostering leadership in others rather than us thinking we have to do everything ourselves. And we do that as nurturers and as caregivers. And so fostering leadership in others really puts them first and helps grow your company. Traditional model of leadership versus servant leadership model. If you want to just go to Pinterest or just Google images of servant leader, you can find some great images like these for your professional development or your staff handbook. You know, but if you're leaning towards a servant leadership model, these would be good kind of show and tell examples. But in the servant leadership model, the customers come first, employees, then the managers, and the leader very last. And Simon Sinek has a great book, Leaders Eat Last. That's a good example of, again, servant leadership type model, where the traditional leadership model, it's like leaders at the top, I'm the boss, do what I say. Oh, managers, make the employees do what I say. Employees, tell the customers how it is. And so you can see that, you know, especially now in our present culture and, you know, again, in 2021, that model is slightly out of date. And I think, you know, the world needs more servant leaders. Again, if you want to Google and dive deep into servant leadership, you could look at these three companies, Starbucks, The Container Store, and Nordstrom. And one thing that they all have in common, besides being servant leadership, is they're a little bit more on the high end. Starbucks coffee is more expensive than Wawa coffee. The Container Store containers or office supplies are more expensive, maybe than Staples or Walmart or Sam's Club. And Nordstrom is a higher end department store versus, you know, a Walmart or a Belk. So what that tells me is that servant leadership model has helped them be very successful and to the point where their branding and their quality is of a high quality. So their leaders are probably extremely successful, and actually we know they are, and you know they're turning a good profit. So companies with strong leadership, servant leadership, are also successful with their bottom line. They're successful with their branding and their quality is good. So win-win-win the whole way around on servant leadership. I worked with a coach probably about 10 years ago, and he had me do an exercise where he said, you know, tell me a place you went where you had, you know, just such great customer service. And I said, it was a particular hotel that my family went to in Arizona. And he said, for our next coaching session, I want you to research that hotel. It happened to be a Ritz-Carlton brand. And I'm not sure which brand it is today, but back then. And the research I found was that they allowed any staff member, any employee at all, from, you know, the maids to the, you know, baristas in the coffee shop to the front desk people, anyone could solve a customer's problem as high up as $300. So if you came with a complaint or a concern, they could make it right no matter what, up to $300. And I think after $300, you had to get permission. Talk about servant leadership and talk about empowering your employees. I absolutely love that. And I talk about that often. Communication, number one for any kind of leadership, servant leadership or regular traditional leadership. Communication is crucial. How many ways do you intentionally communicate with your team? I feel like I communicate all day long. And sometimes when I get home at night, I tell my family I can't talk about anything but Pinterest or recipes because I'm so tired of communicating. And, you know, there's something great about that. But there's also something to be said that maybe there needs to be more widespread communication or more teaming on the communication. But regardless, I find communication to be critical to a successful organization. Always start with your core values. Core values should guide your culture. They should be developed through consensus as much as possible. I like to only have 5 or 6 core values. I have 5, and then I had to have a 6th, which was kindness. And so I called it, all my 5 core values are sprinkled with kindness. But everyone on your team should be able to articulate your core values and how they relate to all the stakeholders. So our stakeholders in the early childhood industry, of course, are the children, number one, always. It's always what's best for the children is what drives our decisions. And then of course, what's best for families and our staff. So our core values guide our decision-making, and when we develop core values, we wanna make sure that everyone knows them and we've had some weigh-in from all the stakeholders. The first thing we want to do is always engage pre-hire in any kind of communication. And so that starts with our tone and our voice on our hiring ads. For instance, if we're doing Indeed ads or ZipRecruiter ads or a Facebook post, if you are an academic type preschool and you're preparing children for college, you know, eventually you're maybe a pre-K through 12th grade type program, your voice and tone will be different than more of a mother goosey infant through 5-year-old type program. And so you want to make sure you have a traditional subject line and title. Don't go too crazy on that because Indeed's algorithms will not like that. But in the content, you can show your voice. One of my favorite ads I saw recently, shout out to Sharon Foster in Georgia. It was a first person kind of ad. I love my job because, you know, where else can you go that you're, you know, get to play with peanut butter Play-Doh, get covered in purple slime and, you know, so on. And you get the idea. And so it was a first person point of view on the ad. And so I found that very engaging rather than, you know, teacher wanted, you know, must, and, you know, you list kind of the job responsibilities. That comes later, but pre-hire engaging, you want to grab their attention because I'll tell you what, if we're not Johnny on the spot, super quick on these hiring ads, we're going to miss out because guess what? They're going to your competitor. Doing posts and doing videos is an awesome idea. Also having your teachers do them, showing teachers having a lot of fun is a great way to engage pre-hire. One thing I know one of the national groups is doing right now, and I just heard about this from one of my colleagues at Hinge, Alec Ligon. Thank you, Alec. Is doing a series of TikTok videos that is very appealing to Gen Z and also the millennials and, you know, lots of people. There's some really fun. Alec didn't. He's a millennial and he did not know much about TikTok. But I said, you know, honestly, like there's some cool TikTok with recipes and makeup tutorials and different kind of how-tos, but there's also, it's a really creative strategy for hiring. So one of the national groups is doing a day in the life of a teacher. And I think that's awesome. You could do a day in the life of the child or, you know, why someone likes working at your school. See if you can get some of your Gen Zers or millennials on board to help with that. I think that's an awesome idea. You know, we're always coaching on going live on Facebook or doing Facebook videos. We love YouTube, but you know, if we wanna get really modern, TikTok might be something to try out. And if you're doing it, please, if you want to try it out, please, you know, let me know how it goes. We're gonna have time in a little bit for some questions and answers, but I love people talking in the chat box and telling me what they're doing. If you don't like the idea, why don't you? And if you do like the idea and have tried it, I wanna hear that for sure. And then engaging pre-hire two-way discussion on core value alignment. So I might say, one of our core values is family. Tell me how that resonates with you. And, you know, that's kind of an easy one, but how is family related to, you know, our team and our staff? How is family related to the children in the classroom? Our classroom is actually their family away from home. So how does that staff member, a potential staff member, relate to that? Phone screening and video meetup, and then inviting in, obviously engaging pre-hire. At any one of these times, you can have an exit out, and as can they, because we don't want to waste time, but we want to make sure that we're conveying all the great things about our program. Oh my gosh, I vet social media always, and I have my team do it too. It is shocking how many people don't have, you know, privacy settings on their social media and are very, very transparent about, you know, their views on the world, or, you know, sort of putting themselves out there. And, you know, our parents fall in love with the teachers, especially when they're the infant toddler teachers for those mamas. Those parents, the first thing they'll do when we introduce a new teacher is they're going to research them. You know, remember, our parents are mostly millennials still. Some are a little bit older, some a little bit younger. And so they are very, very savvy about researching people. They're going to research and find out on social media if there's something inappropriate. And we don't want to have gone through so much work and engaging pre-hire and then have someone not work out. And then consistent questions to remain fair and unbiased. Super important to be unbiased and super fair. So we're actually having, after we do kind of pre-hire interviews and a Zoom, we'll have them go do kind of a working interview in a classroom. And, you know, 30 minutes, they can, you know, engage with the children. But we really want to see how they engage with our teachers as well. And I have the exact same teacher do every single person so that it's as unbiased as possible. Well, or it's biased just by her, but she's one of our master teachers at our school. So she's, you know, vetting everyone against each other. And so it seems pretty fair and very engaging with the new staff. So that's working really well. Staff engagement strategies. So intentional touch points will help us establish a positive emotional engagement within our organization. And so before I kind of go over these, and I'm happy to send slides to you or talk about this later, answer questions, I want to tell you why I came up with this webinar. About a month ago, we had a bump, like I know, hopefully, well, I hope you don't, but I'm sure many of you have had, where someone didn't understand something and we felt it was communicated well, and it in their mind, it wasn't. And, you know, a couple other teachers got on board, oh, our communication, we really need to get better. And the directors were all sort of, I call it chicken little. They thought the sky was falling. The sky is not falling. We have a bump. Let's talk about it. And they were, you know, so kind of anxious about it that I said, let's slow down a minute and think about how we do communicate with our staff. And, you know, do we need to add more things, you know, intentional interactions, or do we have enough and we just need to make sure we're using them? So we were on a an L10 meeting. We do use traction as our model. And I said, everybody just take a deep breath and write down every way we intentionally communicate with our staff. And so they came up with, you know, off the top of their heads, you know, 17, I think. I've got a few more than that today, but I thought I'd just run through them. And you may or may not be doing all of them. You may be doing some, or you may, you know, be doing some of these, and I might throw out a different idea. Certainly, this is when chat box, guys. And just to shout out, we have quite a few people that are really good friends and colleagues of mine and of Hinges on this webinar. And guys, don't be shy. Give us your best ideas, because this makes everybody better. So staff appreciation. I mean, we always do Week of the Young Child. We do lots of appreciation at holidays. We have, you know, parent events and whatnot to show appreciation for staff. But what do we do regularly? And, you know, what kind of system is there? And then how, as a servant leader, can we grow our team? Could we have someone be in charge of staff appreciation and be kind of the site cheerleader? So staff appreciation, that's a pretty obvious one. But what would you do to change it up? the gal I interviewed today said she just keeps a bunch of post-it notes in her office in like a little box, and she writes quotes on the post-its. And anytime someone needs a little pick-me-up, she'll just put a post-it note in their mailbox or have it in their classroom when they arrive for the day, which I thought was just like super cute, adorable, and intentional staff appreciation idea. On-site targeted training, of course we do that, but how else could you do targeted training? Maybe you're going to bring in someone that's a specialist in infant massages and teach your infant teachers how to do infant massages. Or I know the eye doctors in our area will come in and do eye screening for babies. I think it might be called IC, it's an acronym. So targeted training ideas. Of course, team building days. We do this at Hinge. We do, Kathy Ligon, our president and CEO, does an amazing job of engaging us and engaging us with each other. And a couple years ago, we did a really cool team building day at Clemson University. And it was really fun. And so you just got everybody on the team together to do all these like crazy. It wasn't a ropes course, but it was similar. Super cool team building. And then you kind of stepped back and kind of processed, oh, who was talking the most in this activity? Who stood back and listened? Who's the planner? Very fun idea on team building days. If you've got universities near you, many times they will do things like that. And as I said, shout out to Clemson University. They did a really good one for our Hinge team a couple years ago. Obviously, we do orientation and onboarding. What can we do to systemize it? And what can we do in terms of servant leadership to let our staff know how much we depend on them and answer their questions ahead of time? Obviously, professional development days. I love doing them offsite. We're actually, I think, going to a church this year and doing professional development day. A lot of people do the Airbnbs, and I think that's fantastic if you get it for a couple days. I know Alita Mechtel from Children of Tomorrow out of in Minnesota does an amazing professional development kind of retreat. And she gets an Airbnb and brings her key leaders, assistant directors and directors in for a couple days. The main executive kind of gals stay longer. They'll go out on golf courses. They'll do scavenger hunts. I mean, she brought them back to the house for dinner and everybody had a little Tiffany box as a gift. So you can go crazy like Alita, or you can do something like I'm going to do, which is just at a local church, but we're going to bring in a food truck, you know, the best burger food truck in town. And so, you know, you can do it within a budget, or you can do it, you know, as a big wow. Obviously, career ladders, they filter in with your staff evaluations, but again, a servant leader will be wanting to grow the team individually. And so what I tell my staff, and certainly I don't have all the answers by any means, I'm counting on all of you to help me with some more ideas. But what I like to do is say, no matter how long you're with us, I want you to leave, you know, with more skills and, you know, with lots of great experience that will serve you well in your next step in your life. You know, maybe they're in the public schools, or maybe they're staying home with children, or maybe they're going to a different program or back to school. Weekly staff meetings seem to be a really good ticket. It's hard with COVID, and I know for the last year we've been really flexible, all of us in, you know, the early childhood community, not having people stay late or you know really engage with them. Rather, we were trying to allow people to be home with their families. But weekly staff meetings don't have to be drudgery. They could be at, you know, your Panera. And, you know, let's all get some soup and sit down and talk about X, Y, and Z. Or they could be Zoom. I know we're sick of Zoom, but it works great. And it's a really good way for staff to, you know, be home and still engaged at work. Monthly evaluations, absolutely. Monthly evaluations, I think, should feed into career ladder goals. Certainly, we meet with staff face-to-face. And, you know, our directors are really good in general at speaking with each staff. But, you know, that face-to-face during maybe a morning message, we do a morning message at our schools and like to you know, either we'll virtually send it into there through, we use tadpoles at the moment, but you can have it on a clipboard printed out so that when the staff come in, maybe the ones that come in for breaks or substitutes also have it written as well. So again, written communication. And just to back up for a minute about communication, we want to remember that, and this is so hard for me. Remember when I said I feel like I talk a lot all day long? Over the years, we do. We're repeating ourselves a lot. And so how do we keep it fresh for ourselves? And how do we let our staff know, you know, what we expect? And we need to make sure we're listening and looking at the recipient. You know, are they receiving, you know, the words we're saying? They might not want to hear our words verbally. They might rather an email. They might rather, you know, waiting till the staff meeting or a one-on-one in an office. So we want to make sure that we understand how they receive information and how they like feedback. Virtual sticky notes is a really good way to do it. Whatever apps you use, you can usually send some type of sticky note or some type of reminder. You know, maybe we're doing a fire drill. So virtual sticky note, hey, in the next day or so, because I don't like to tell them exactly when it's happening. I think it's more authentic and safer to not. We're, you know, almost time for fire drill this month. Everyone, you know, reminders about fire drill, you know, make sure X, Y, and Z. Virtual emails. I mean, obviously emails are a great way to communicate with our staff. We particularly like GroupMe, and we have specific channels on GroupMe that we use. We do a director one, we'll do the A-team one that's just like a couple people on it. We name our groups to make it fun. And then each of our locations will have a GroupMe. I participate in all of them because I want our staff to see that I'm very, very engaged with them. Pre-COVID, I was not doing that quite as much because the team was, you know, kind of had everything and the systems in place. But I'm finding coming back from COVID, it's a little different, and we're having to reset some of our boundaries and procedures and processes. Oh, sorry. And then ProCare email groups, whatever financial or communication tool you're using, usually there's ways to email. Maybe you're a multi-site and you have infants and you want to reach out to your infant team. Infants, we're doing a curriculum development meeting, XYZ date and time. Everyone is welcome to come, or everyone is required to come, whatever the case may be. But letting everyone know, please email back that you've received this, or please RSVP. You know, there's quite a few apps also on RSVPing to events as well. And then I like daily sign-out logs. I don't know how many of you do that, but ours is pencil paper. We've toyed with virtual where they got emailed. And honestly, the pencil paper seems to be better as far as directors responding. So it's just a half page front and back, and the staff fills out, you know, the basics, you know, any injuries, any maintenance issues, anything happen in the room that needs follow-up, any questions. I actually have them rate their day 1 to 10. And 10 is like, spectacular day, couldn't be better. I wanna stay here all night. My day was so good. 2, you know, a 1 is my day was horrible. I hate my job. Or I had the worst headache, my day was horrible. You know, it's not always about us. We feel like it is because we're such nurturers and we care so much, but sometimes it's just they're going through something at home. And so rating their day. But then what I have my directors do is really track that. We keep them in a particular file, not licensing file, not really their, you know, actual Bright Beginnings file, but just a, you know, just a sort of a staff location file. And if there's a trend of a 7 or below, you know, maybe for a week or so, we'll definitely bring the staff in for like one-on-one, you know, what's going on? I'm noticing you're really having, you know, struggling. What can I do? How can I help? And that, again, back to the servant leadership, what can I do? How can I help? And it's usually something like, I hate my schedule. I can't stay past 5:30. Or it's my coworker that you just hired needs more training. You know, great, speak up. What do we need to do? How can we help? Thank you so much for that feedback. Thank you cards and gifts. I mean, obviously, and this would be, and same with 17 shout outs. This is really important that we do something either with the five languages of appreciation. How does someone want to be appreciated? They might like that written thank you note, or they might like a shout out on your morning message or in your group me. Oh my gosh, last night I was watching our group me for one of our schools. It was a complete love fest. One of the cute girls, Sophie, one of our college girls, is leaving, and she was saying goodbye and thanking everyone on the group meet, even though she's going to be at school today. She was, you know, it was really sweet, and everybody is just giving her love and kudos, and I can't wait to see you. We're going to go to lunch. I'll meet you for dinner. Like, oh my gosh, it made me so happy. So sometimes those kind of thank yous are very organic and just happen. And it makes you think like, oh my gosh, this is awesome. It makes you so happy. And then gifts, what kind of gifts do staff appreciate and want? I mean, sometimes a gift is, I'm gonna sweep up your classroom after lunch because that mac and cheese is gross on the floor. Or it's a Starbucks cart. Maybe they don't like Starbucks and they like Dunkin' Donuts better. If you know and can differentiate, bonus points, and that makes a big difference to a staff member. And then just those, like I told you, the gal I interviewed today that does the post-it note quotes, really cool. Shout outs, how do you shout out? Do people like public or private shout outs? I have a gal, Miss Jessie, she's a baby teacher at one of our schools. Oh my gosh, I did a shout out publicly to her at a staff meeting, all of our schools together. She did not appreciate that. She did and didn't, you know, but a shout out where it was much more important to her that she hears it from me directly one-on-one, you know, so that would be like, Miss Jessie, I just so much appreciate the love and care you give our babies every single day, meant more to her that I would be looking at her, talking to her and in her room rather than, you know, just saying it publicly. So knowing our staff, that makes a big difference. And then walkie-talkies, that's one of our tricks. If you don't have intercoms at your school, and sometimes intercoms can be a little corporate, and not that there's anything wrong with that, and I'm all about anything to keep kids safe, so intercoms can be very safe. Walkie-talkies are also a really easy, quick idea because the teachers can be out on the playground or the outdoor classroom spaces and communicating with the front desk. We use them a lot right now because we're still not having parents in our buildings where the parents are pulling up and we're using the walkie-talkies. That's not that new or creative, but it is a way to engage with your staff intentionally. We'll also use our walkie-talkies to remind them when a tour is ready to come in the building, just so everybody's kind of on their A game, because I think tours are Super Bowls. Let's see, number 19, birthdays, anniversaries, or milestones. Every month, every first Friday of every month, we celebrate birthdays and anniversaries. It's a fun tradition that we've done forever, but I bet, and I bet you do it, but do you do it and take it to the next level with, you know, something quirky or different? We use Silly String, and we used to, before COVID, have the cake in the hall and all the classrooms came out and sang happy birthday to the teacher. And then it would take like green or blue silly string. And oh, the kids just giggled and squealed. And it was very fun. Now we just do it in the during lunch. But, you know, something silly like silly string, you know, that it's a tradition. What do you do that's a fun tradition at your school? And then milestones. Milestones don't have to be work milestones. We have Miss Margaret, talk about her a lot, at one of our schools, is cancer free. She's been struggling with cancer for several years. And she just came to school the other day and said, I am cancer free. Like, talk about a milestone. Awesome. Love languages. We talked about love languages in connection with languages of appreciation. But what does mean something to each of you, because honestly, we just did this really fun shout out and my love language is kudos. I like people to thank me. I like to be recognized at, you know, at my school. I love gifts too. I like coffee, but I really like to, for people to notice that, you know, I'm working hard on their behalf. And so we just did National Lipstick Day last week and we got oh my gosh, we spend a lot of money on all these cool lipsticks. And then we, you know, for the males on our team or the people that aren't like lipstick type, we did the SPF, you know, the Burt's Bees SPF chapsticks and, you know, just the fun, like we appealed to everybody and we wrapped up lipstick in these little baggies. Could you go get me the lipstick bags? Thank you. I'm going to do a show and tell maybe. And we did lollipops and lipstick. And so we put lollipops and lipstick in a little bag with a bow and gave them to everybody and just surprised everyone. And I was surprised that I didn't get any thank yous. I don't know if they're just used to us doing fun things for them, but we felt like that was a really fun thing to do. And I mentioned it to one of our team members and said, you know, when you talk about love language, don't forget about letting people know what you need as well. Because as leaders, if we're not, you know, feeling that we're making a difference or feeling that, you know, our contributions are recognized, you know, it kind of hurts our feelings and maybe we're not going to be willing to do as much. So that's me being pretty authentic and a little vulnerable, but I get it. And, you know, when we try really hard for our staff, you know, we want them to know we're working on their behalf. Stand-up meetings. I love this. Have you ever gone to Walmart or Costco or Sam's or, I don't know, pretty much any place at opening? Target, I've seen it at Target. I saw it at the airport the other week with the TSA workers. I'm talking about a stand-up meeting. Stand-up meetings are super effective because they're very quick. Here's what you need to know. Here's the deal for the day. So a stand-up meeting with your staff, especially if they're all still coming in at the same time and not staggering schedules in or not. Oh, thank you. My assistant Molly is here. So this is what we did. We did like really cute lipsticks and lollipops. And I know they did actually love them because I heard later they absolutely love them. But anyway, that's my show and tell. So anyway, stand-up meetings are an awesome way to engage with your staff very quickly. Instead of sitting down and everybody, here's the agenda. There's a place for that, but doing a stand-up meeting is also quick. I'm doing stand-up meetings by phone in the mornings right now. I only have a couple schools, three schools. And so you can merge your directors into a call. And I do it at 7:45. I have it set on my alarm on my phone. And I just call everybody and we just talk about what's going on for the day. You know, we're short-staffed. We're working on hiring right now. Oh, we've got tours. How are we going to manage the tours? Who needs what? How can we help? And it's just a quick 5 minute where everybody knows kind of what everybody else has planned for the day. Stand-up meetings work great. And then happy hour with leadership. I actually really think this is great. And I got this from one of our Thrive attendees, Melissa DeSosa from Little People's College. Shout out, Melissa. This is an awesome one. So doing a Zoom happy hour with leadership. So it could be happy hour and you're having wine at your house and they are too. Or it could just be happy to be able to talk to you. Pick a time every week where, especially if you're multi-site, and she has, I think, 7 locations. So where you just have a Zoom interview or a Zoom schedule planned and people can pop in to talk to you. They might pop in and ask, you know, a quick question about, you know, curriculum, or they might say, give you a suggestion, but a happy hour with leadership is awesome. And if, you know, you're just available at the same time every week. It's kind of like a professor in a college might have office hours. Same idea, except you can do it from home. And then pro tip, stages of a team. We talk about this a lot when I'm working with clients and also with my team. So the stages of a team, no matter what, you're not going to get away from these stages. It's, you know, science behind it. It was a study from Berkeley University in the 60s and still holds true. There's actually a 5th stage, which is adjourning once people leave. But when a team starts and forms, it's kind of the honeymoon stage. Everything goes great. People are really excited to be together. We're excited that we've hired someone and the person is excited they've got a job. So it's kind of the honeymoon stage. And then shortly after, maybe a few days, a few weeks, not longer than a few weeks, there's some type of storm. the person misses work, the person complains about something, maybe they didn't understand because our intentional communication maybe missed something, happens, there's a storm. If you're telling people ahead of time that you can predict there's going to be a storm, somebody's going to be unhappy, we're going to have to work through it. And this is what people do in relationships. We work through the bumps. We work through it with our best friends, with our spouses or significant others, with our children. So a storm is normal. After everything gets straightened out, kind of normalize. Things get better. Everybody kind of knows their boundaries. Everyone knows strengths and weaknesses of the other person or people. And then eventually you get to performing. Performing is we're doing this together in this picture that they're running a race and one is passing the baton to the next runner. So that's ultimately our goal. And then the fifth stage is the adjourning stage where people leave. And what does that look like? And that happens to our teachers a lot. Somebody leaves to go to your competitor for a dollar more an hour. All of a sudden, your teachers are wondering, maybe I should go too. Or maybe they're going back to school and they're wondering, maybe I should go back to school. And so when that adjourning part happens, that's a loss. And you know, we want to acknowledge that. So stages of a team, what is interesting about stages of a team is that the form, once someone leaves, we have to all go back to forming again. We're replacing that person, or even if we're not, we're forming a new team. What are we doing if a director leaves, for instance, and you know, directors from another location are supporting or helping out? Everybody has new responsibilities. So essentially the team is reforming. And I would love questions, and I'd like to look at the chat box and see if anyone has anything to contribute or ideas. We have finished slightly early, which is unusual for me. Let you go a couple minutes and see if anyone has any questions. And while I'm doing, while you guys are thinking about any questions or ideas, I wanted to see if all of you had gotten the latest ProCare report. Of course, you won't get it if you're not a ProCare customer. And if you're not, I'm happy to give you some of this information at my email, which is kpetchel, P-E-T-C-H-E-L at hingebrokers.com. According to ProCare, and here's a map of all the United States, lots and lots of recovery, but it's tracking how close states are to returning to February 2020 attendance levels versus now. And also it tracks recovery state by state. What is the trend in attendance recovery by state? And so there's certain outliers, like Hawaii has recovered incredibly well. I'm in Virginia and we're more on the iffy end. We're getting there though. So different states are recovering at different rates. And it's something, if you're thinking about selling, it's something we look at, you know, as you're recovering, you want to make sure you're working on your enrollment and you want to make sure that you're working on having all your staff in place. But recovery is definitely a factor for all of us with our growth right now. And that said, it's also a really good time to grow. And I know when I say this to clients, I say, you know, it's a good time to grow. And everyone always thinks we mean just buy another building or rent space at another building and add, like, you know, a fifth facility if you have four, or a tenth if you have nine. Not necessarily. It could be we're going to grow into the infant care, and or we're going to grow into before and after school care, wraparound care, for instance. So you might need to go get a bus, or you might need to talk to your public schools about getting on the bus route, but you could grow with before and after school care. Remember, I was talking a minute ago about ProCare and, you know, their statistics on recovery. Those are great ways to bump up your recovery a little faster, adding age groups, adding before and after school care, even adding Saturday care or extending hours. Parents are going to be looking different right now as far as, you know, their work schedules. And so possibly something, any of those ideas might serve you really well. And then the last thing I wanted to remind everyone about in terms of engagement, and this would be like engagement in your community, would be making sure you're figuring out how you can be an advocacy partner with your local and your state groups. We have a group in Virginia, the Virginia Child Care Association, and we work together with for legislature in Virginia. There's national groups, there's and then there's, you know, smaller regional groups as well. And I would highly recommend right now, as you're coming back and successfully navigating this new world, that you jump on the advocacy train, because that's where the federal money is going to be filtered through our advocacy groups. So jumping in and having a seat at that table would be really important. And Carrie, I'm just looking to see if, do we just have a super quiet group today? Here we go. How do you engage staff with COVID protocols in mind? Great question. Okay, so, well, keeping everybody healthy is number one. So engaging with staff on meetings, you know, I don't know your area. It really, remember I talked about the COVID or the recovery trends for ProCare. It depends on where you are and what your comfort level is, your staff's comfort level, and any of the regulations in your state or local. So I always follow all those rules. I mean, in Virginia, we're still wearing masks in childcare, but you know, you go pretty much everywhere else, it's, you know, it's the person's choice mostly. I don't think I've gone any place lately that required me to wear a mask, including like my hairdresser or Target or restaurants. And of course it depends on about whether they're fully vaccinated, although we know people are still getting COVID despite being vaccinated. So, I mean, I look at the staff level of, you know, fear and health, which is why about 50% of these ideas were virtual or able to be, you know, at least socially distanced. But great question. And I don't know if there's anything specific besides that that you're referring to. Oh, Christine's saying, I'm in another meeting. This is super helpful and much appreciated. Thanks, Christine. I appreciate that. So I think I'm just gonna wrap up then. If anyone has any questions, that of course, the second I wrap up, you'll think of five questions, and you can certainly email me, absolutely, or you can email our info question to Carrie as well. But hopefully this has been helpful to you all, and I've certainly enjoyed working with everyone here. Oh, thanks for the information. Thanks, Judith, nice to meet you. Hopefully, and I'm happy to share these slides as well. If anyone would like the slides, happy to do that and always happy to connect. So thank you everyone for attending, and we will see you next month at another session. And hopefully I see lots and lots of you at our shift event coming up in October. Thank you so much.